Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Please be seated. The Honorable Mia Amor Motley, Prime Minister of Barbados, members of Cabinet, members of the Senate, members of Parliament, Governor of the Central Bank of Barbados, Dr. Kevin Greenidge, Sir Elliot and Lady Motley, members of the Board of Directors of the Central Bank of Barbados, former governors of the Central Bank of Barbados, Mr. Cleviston Haynes and Dr. Mariana Williams, our distinguished lecturer, Professor Mariana Mazzucato, management and staff of the Central Bank of Barbados, members of the Scott family, members of the media, visiting dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening and welcome to the 48th Sir Winston Scott Memorial Lecture. I am Noveline Brewster, Chief of Corporate Communications at the Central Bank of Barbados, and I am honored to MC this beautiful tradition of the bank and the country. Thanks for joining us in person for the first time since 2019. We are happy to host this event again in person, because between 2020 and 2022, COVID forced us to pivot to an online conversation. Today, we pay tribute to our first Native Governor General, the late Sir Arleigh Winston Scott, and we celebrate our nation's second anniversary of republicanism and our 57th year of independence. These achievements fill us with great pride. I feel especially honored to be a Bajan after hearing the young gentlemen of the St. Leonard's Boys School render our national anthem with magnificence, enthusiasm, and luster. The bank is also pleased to welcome to the hall and to Barbados Italian, American, British economist, Professor Mariana Mazzucato. We met today and she's a lovely lady. We had a great conversation. And she's professor in the economics of innovation and public value at University College London and one of the world's most influential economists. We'll hear from her shortly, but first, I invite Governor Dr. Kevin Greenidge to welcome our lecturer and you to this event and to deliver remarks. Governor?
The Honorable Mia Moore-Montley, Prime Minister of Barbados, members of Cabinet, members of the Senate, members of Parliament, members of the Board of Directors of the Central Bank of Barbados, former governors of the Central Bank of Barbados, Dr. Marion Williams and Mr. Cleverson Haynes, our distinguished lecturer, Professor Mariana Mazzucato, management and staff of the Central Bank of Barbados, members of the Scott family, members of the media, visiting dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening and welcome to the 48th Sir Winston Scott Memorial Lecture. I'm sure for the regular attendees of this lecture, being back in the hall is a welcome return home. Like you, I am pleased this year, my first year as governor, that we are once again gathering in person after 3 years of being virtual. While the virtual format was a departure from what we are accustomed to, we at the bank felt it was important, even during those challenging times, to continue to bring this event, which I'm proud to say is one of the island's longest running lecture series, to all the people of Barbados. The Sir Winston Scott Memorial Lecture was a brainchild of our founding father, Sir Courtney Blackman, early in his tenure. Sir Courtney was adamant that the Central Bank of Barbados should be a part of the community it serves and establish the lecture as a way to expose Barbadians of all walks of life to the insightful and often internationally recognized speakers on various topics. Sir Courtney felt that the series positioned the bank as a thoughtful leader and expose Barbadians to new ideas and new developments. He prepared us for a globalized world. I, like successive governors, am pleased to uphold Sir Courtney's legacy and continue this rich tradition. Our guest this evening, Professor Mariana Mazzucato, is an economist, one who is both well-known and well-respected. But the Sir Winston Scott Memorial Lecture is not limited to economic topics. And this was a deliberate decision on the bank's part. Indeed, since its inception in 1976, we've hosted a wide array of speakers, including poets, healthcare professionals, culture practitioners, scientists, clergy, even an astronomer we have hosted. People have gathered here in these halls for discourse on topics such as philanthropy, communication, globalization, technology, and climate change. You will no doubt agree that even though the topics are varied, they are all relevant to us here in Barbados. The bank is committed to providing a platform for Barbadians from all walks of life to hear from and engage with thoughtful leaders who have different perspectives to offer. In doing so, we connect academics, professional students, some of them are in the crowd tonight, and anyone with a particular interest in any area with access to visionaries and game changers, like the professor. I am confident this year's lecture and guest speaker will carry on this legacy. In a few moments, you will be properly introduced to Professor Mariana Mazzucato. So I will resist the urge to preempt that. But I will say that she is an advisor to governments all over the globe, including our very own here in Barbados. In fact, she recently offered a report entitled A Mission-Oriented Strategy for Inclusive and Sustainable Economic Growth in Barbados, which, in my opinion, provides a roadmap for transforming the big challenges we face as a nation into opportunities for investment and targeted innovation. Her topic tonight is directing inclusive and sustainable growth, a mission-oriented approach. This is an important theme for us as a country and a bank, given the challenges, uncertainties, natural and man-made disasters we continue to face. And as a small, open, and vulnerable economy, we get hit hard, bouncing back in a way that includes everyone is and must be our goal as we craft economic, social, and environmental policies. I therefore encourage you to fully avail yourself of this opportunity, not only to hear directly from her during her presentation, but also to engage her during her discussion and the ensuing discussion with the Prime Minister of Barbados. This opportunity is possible because of the Scott family, who allow us to honor their patriot, Sir Winston Scott, Barbados' first Native Governor General, an outstanding physician and an outstanding philosopher. Ms. Hope, Dr. Hope, we see this lecture as a key element of our efforts to be a center of excellence, not just on economic matters, but also in relation to education, thought, leadership. So we truly value your support and continued attendance at this event. Ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate your attendance as well. And we look forward to your participation during the discussion and the question and answer period as we work together to find solutions that will lead to inclusive and sustainable economic growth for the country we love and call our home. Thank you.
And thank you so much, Governor, for contextualizing this event and providing us with the history of this, behind this series. Before we hear from our guest lecturer, we pause for an interlude of music by one of Barbados's promising young saxophonists, Daniel Harvey, performing Emerton. our governor spoke of Sokourtney's, that we're celebrating Sokourtney's vision this evening by hosting this lecture series. And our late governor and founding father was also a big promoter of the arts, so we celebrate his legacy in this way as well by having one of our promising young musicians perform for us. So thank you so much, Daniel, for that splendiferous performance. As I said, it is was by Barbadian classic, it's a Barbadian classic, sorry, by Dr. the Most Honorable Anthony the Mighty Gabby Carter. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you'll have lots of questions for a speaker. To pose them, please log on to www.slido.com and enter the event code Scott Lecture, and that's one word. I'm sure you have the Wi-Fi credentials already. And now is the big moment to hear from Professor Mariana Mazzucato, who will speak to us in a minute or two on the topic, Directing Inclusive and Sustainable Economic Growth, a Mission-Oriented Approach. Before she takes to the stage, I invite you to view this introductory video that gives us some insights on our lecturer. And once the video is finished, she'll come and present. Thank you.
Mariana Mazzucato is professor in the Economics of Innovation and Public Value at University College, UCL, where she is founding director of the UCL Institute for Innovation and Public Purpose. She is the winner of international prizes, including the Grand Ufficiale Ordine al Merito della Repubblica Italiana in 2021, Italy's highest civilian honor, the 2020 John von Neumann Award, the 2019 All-European Academies Madame de Staël Prize for Cultural Values, and 2018 Leontief Prize for Advancing the Frontiers of Economic Thought. Most recently, Pope Francis appointed her to the Pontifical Academy for Life for bringing more humanity to the world. She is the author of The Entrepreneurial State, Debunking Public versus Private Sector Myths, 2013, The Value of Everything, Making and Taking in the Global Economy, 2018, Mission Economy, A Moonshot Guide to Changing Capitalism, 2021, and most recently, The Big Con, How the Consulting Industry Weakens Our Businesses, Infantilizes Our Governments, and Warps Our Economies, 2023. She advises policymakers around the world on innovation-led, inclusive, and sustainable growth. Her current roles include being the chair of the World Health Organization's Council on the Economics of Health for All, co-chair of the Global Commission on the Economics of Water, and a member of the South African President's Economic Advisory Council. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome to the stage Professor Mariana Mazzucato to deliver the 2023 Sir Winston Scott Memorial Lecture on Directing Inclusive and Sustainable Economic Growth, a Mission-Oriented Approach.
Wow. I had no idea that video was going to happen. Thank you so much. It is such an honor to be here. I feel like I'm at the center of a large ocean state that is helping the world really rethink the direction of where we want to go. We can do capitalism very differently, very differently. But first, can I thank the Honorable Mia Amor Motley, the Prime Minister of Barbados, but really a global leader. And I feel so humbled to say for the last year, can I call you my colleague around this report? Obviously not just with the government, also the social partnership. And today I had a wonderful lunch with the managers of the central bank to extend that feedback that we really want to get on this report. And thank you so much to the governor of the Central Bank of Barbados, Dr. Kevin Greenidge. I pronounced your name very well. I'm going to test you later to pronounce mine a bit better. But hey, it's hard. I told him today my actual name is even harder. It's even harder. It's Mariana, Maria, Ginetta, Francesca, Romana, Mazzucato. He's got to get the Mazzucato right. It's not a car. It's not Maserati. This is on. Anyway. And of course, members of Cabinet, Senate, Parliament, and even the Scott family, which I had the pleasure to meet quickly. We even tried to do something mischievous together but failed. Anyway, we won't say what we tried to do. Everyone who's here in the audience. And what I've been told to do is not to go over 30 minutes. If there's anything I don't go over, because we have, of course, a wonderful discussion to be had, both with the Prime Minister, but we want to open it up to others. So let me try to be relatively quick, which is hard, because what I want to talk about tonight is something we all know, but it's just not talked about, right? Which is, what is the economy? There's no economic pressure out there. There's no economic forces forcing companies to do what they've done for the last 10 years, buying back their shares to boost stock prices, stock options, and executive pay. Not all companies, but some. So this financialized form of corporate governance, maximizing shares. There's no law out there forcing companies to do that. There's no law out there forcing the public sector to, at best, put patches here and there, talk about financing gaps as though there's a hole somewhere to fill with finance. There's no deterministic way to think about the economy. The economy itself is an outcome of how we govern all the different organizations, public, private, civil society organizations that are so important in the history of capitalism, and the relationships between them. And this is really what I want to talk about, to remind all of us that capitalism, there's different ways to do it, and we have a very problematic way of doing capitalism, which has gotten us crisis after crisis, interlinked crises, the financial crisis, the climate crisis, the biodiversity crisis, and we need to get out of this in a proactive way. We need to stop having crises to react to. If we keep doing that, we will always be too little, too late. We are designing ourselves into being in these crises. And the, how does this move forward? There we go. And one of the things that I find so inspirational is that your prime minister in this country is now at the center of the global map, because we've woken up to the fact that, for example, finance is not neutral. We don't just need more money. Money is not just a means of exchange facilitating the wheels of commerce. We've had a problematic form of finance. So if in thinking about the $7 trillion financial gap, those are the words that are used for the Sustainable Development Goals, getting out of this problem means, first of all, changing how we think about that lack of finance. We need to restructure the finance. And your prime minister talks about the double jeopardy. Countries like Barbados and many in the global south, I don't like the word global south, but let me just use it now to speed things up, that are bearing the consequences of the wrong way that we've done capitalism, creating this massive climate crisis. But the double jeopardy is that we've also created an international financial system that not only is not prepared to deal with that, but has actually also contributed to the crisis itself by having, for example, very problematic conditions tied to loans provided to countries, conditional often on reducing public investment and public spending with some voodoo number of the deficit figure that needs to be met. We actually also haven't prepared countries to think in this proactive way of how to structure public finance, public investment, in order to not just expand the productive capacity of a country, but also to expand it in a way of what I'll be talking about today to make sure it's in fact inclusive and sustainable. And you know what's interesting is the IMF and the World Bank, which have in fact been part of the problem, are starting to wake up. And of course, there's also some new leadership there that helps, but there was also papers over the last 5 years, in fact, on the back of the financial crisis, where globally some of the recovery programs were based on conditionality of austerity. I've been living in Europe, and the European recovery after the financial crisis for the member states in Europe was conditional on those member states cutting their deficits. That's how the recovery programs would get dispersed. So my own country did that, Italy. We reduced our deficit. We were even running a surplus, as though that was like the big objective. And surprise, surprise, our debt to GDP rose, right? Forgetting that there's a ratio. X over zero is infinity. You don't have to have a PhD in mathematics to know that. So if you're not actually making those critical private and public investments that lead to long-run growth in the denominator, you could actually be reducing the numerator and the ratio itself increases. And of course, the point is not just growth for growth's sake in that denominator. It's precisely to make sure it's growth that's good for people and planet. But if we don't even understand the basics and just start cutting public investment in the name of making our economies healthier again, we get into a huge problem. And really interesting that the IMF and the World Bank themselves have published papers on just how problematic austerity proved to be. And unfortunately, we haven't learned the lessons. If you look around the world, austerity is indeed back. After, for example, recovery programs happen, then we say, oh, but now we must tighten our belts. Now it's the time to retract again. So of course, that shouldn't be the conversation. The conversation should be, how do we direct economic growth? Growth has not just a rate, but a direction. How can we stop fixing, being in this bandage mode of fixing market failures? That's the fancy way that economists like to speak. Economists always have this insecurity complex with anthropologists and sociologists, and so brought in all this Newtonian physics, mathematics about equilibria and averages in order to show how important they were at the time that physics was abandoning Newtonian physics and bringing in quantum and the physics of chaos and so on. And so market failure fixing doesn't get us a healthier, more inclusive, sustainable, innovation-driven economy. We have to shape markets. We have to create markets. And so what does that mean? That's really what I want to talk about today, and how that might sound very high-level and fancy and kind of philosophical. Market creation, market shaping, taking from so many great quotes from your prime minister. What is the difference between that and market fixing? That's what I want to talk about. How can we have an outcome-oriented type of policy, outcome-oriented partnerships, symbiotic, mutualistic, not parasitic partnerships between all the different value-creating actors in the economy. And forgive my self-promotional slide here, but the video was even more self-promotional, so this slide doesn't look too bad. But this is really what I've tried to write about and to think about over the last 10 or 15 years, and it's also why I set up a department. It's not just an institute, a department at University College London, because it's impossible to get better policies if we don't actually have a new way to think about the economy itself, new training about also the vocabulary that we're using. We're so stuck with thinking that value creation happens in the private sector, and at best the public sector can facilitate, enable, de-risk, the word I dislike the most. If one side is de-risking and the other side is taking risks, where would you rather work? It becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And so this idea that at best we need different bandages, by the way, to do good stuff. If you look at market failure theory, it kind of sounds very convincing. When you don't have enough investment in public goods sound good, two words, one is good, then you need the government to come in and fix that problem, whether it's basic research and development, clean water, defense system. But it's a correction. It's not an objective. The common good, which the Pope talks about to me, is an objective that we're trying to reach, and then the nitty-gritty of the how becomes the question. If the public good is just a correction for something the private sector is not doing, you almost start approaching it sad, right? You don't even have that kind of a positive spirit of thinking proactively, how will we actually make those decisions of where we want to go together and pay attention to the details. But also negative externalities, the opposite of positive externalities, pollution, what do we need? We need government to come in and do things like carbon taxes, which are, by the way, very important. We don't have enough of them globally, but is that enough? If we're looking at all these externalities, positive and negative externalities, by definition, again, we end up in this bandaging up mode. And there's these huge goals out there that people talk about, every country has signed up to, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, which came about after a lot of consultation globally. But what do they mean? What does it mean to sign up? You know, Barbados has signed up, the United States has signed up, South Africa has signed up, every country basically has signed up to the Sustainable Development Goals. So what does it mean if we have goals? Can we actually tackle them by fixing market failures, by patching things up, by de-risking? Or do we actually need a goal-oriented economy? And how can we turn these challenges? I mean, all the goals here are talking about pretty terrible things. Poverty, hunger, bad health. What does good health and well-being mean for everybody? Quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation. What does it mean, though, to really tackle these in a goal-oriented way, to actually structure our economies to deliver on them? And part of that video talked about a council, which I had the fortune to chair. I founded it and chaired it with Dr. Tedros, the head of the World Health Organization. It was called the Council on the Economics of Health for All. Because the idea was, yes, of course we should invest in health, and it's good for the economy, and most countries don't do that, right? The cost of inaction, of not investing in health, is much greater than the cost of action, like climate change. But it's not enough to talk about it that way. What if health for all was the goal? How would you actually design the economic system to deliver on that? And just to bring it down to earth, when we had COVID, what should the goal have been? Well, to vaccinate the entire world, right? And if that was the goal, the way that we actually produced the vaccines, right, that's what I mean by doing capitalism, doing business, doing distribution, doing consumption, the way that we actually produced those vaccines should have been done in light of the goal. Instead, we didn't do that. We didn't actually structure the intellectual property rights system, the design of the public-private partnership with that goal in mind. And some companies did. It was interesting to see the difference between the AstraZeneca Oxford vaccine and the Pfizer one. And the reason the AstraZeneca vaccine, which shouldn't be called that way, because there was lots of different actors creating it, was in fact produced with much weaker patents, joining a patent pool, lower cost and lower price, was that was fruit of a negotiation with the publicly funded Oxford University researchers. Oxford is a state school, I like to call it that. And those state-funded researchers put that as a condition when they were working with AstraZeneca. Why? Because they cared about the goal during a global health pandemic, right, to actually make sure that that vaccine could also be produced globally. And so that's what I mean by goal-oriented economy. And of course, we have economies with lots of problems, but transforming the problems that are being faced, whoops, that's the wrong slide. Have these been moving without me the whole time? No, that should just be there. Oh, I've been touching this too much. Okay, transforming the problems that are in an economy into opportunities for investment and innovation between many different actors is what I want to talk about. So tackling poverty, youth crime and inclusion, a just transition. Tackling climate change and greening the entire economic system, a green and blue transition. Tackling an aging population and rise in non-communicable diseases, a health transition. Tackling digitalization of government services, and resilient digital infrastructure, a digital transition. These are the transitions that I learned about in my three different visits. This is the third time I've come to Barbados, in talking with the actors on the ground that are talking about what is the direction, where do we want to go, what is the point of talking about better policy if we don't actually talk about that direction? What does a transition mean? And the reason I wrote Mission Economy was that in looking at the space program, right, because the space program in different countries is often the most outcome-oriented one, I realized that it would have been impossible for NASA to actually have gone to the moon, to have directed that project, that transition, without changing the economic system. It was not just an aerospace feat, it was a political economic feat. And what was so interesting to me, and I want to kind of, you know, talk about why we have been engaging with the Prime Minister and her team and the social partnership around a mission-oriented vision for Barbados, is that the language, the narrative, the partnership, the ecosystem, the design of the policies, the tools and institutions have to all actually change. We need social innovation. We need technological innovation. We need organizational innovation in order to tackle the problems that the country is facing. And what was so interesting in Kennedy's famous speeches that he gave around the Apollo program was the language, in fact. He said, we're doing it because it's hard, not because it's easy. And that language of tackling uncertainty, embracing underlying experimentation, is so different from the language that we often use in that policy world, which gets us these problematic policies that are, as I've been saying, reactive, too little, too late, fixing problems and filling financial gaps. He also said, because we're doing it because it's hard, not because it's easy, we might mess up along the way. But what they actually did that was interesting was not just to give speeches. The people in charge, for example, this guy Ernest Brackett, who is in charge of procurement, so government purchasing, procurement is often a huge percentage of government budget, said, we're not going to get to the moon with the current design of procurement. We have to move away from a cost-plus method, where government's just kind of paying people to do stuff without any ambition, towards challenge-oriented procurement. And he did so in such a way that also focused, or the whole program focused on getting as many different sectors as possible working together. There was nutrition, materials, electronics, software, and many more. If you haven't seen Hidden Figures, watch it, how the role of African American women in the computing innovation that was required to get to the moon and back. But all these different sectors that were working together, 400,000 people in the public and the private sector, but in many different industries working together, didn't just happen on its own. First of all, the outcomes of those interactions were solutions to the hundreds of homework problems that had to be solved. So we got camera phones, foil blankets, baby formula, and again, I mentioned software. But what was interesting was that the way that those sectors worked together happened because government paid attention to the problem, which was getting to the moon and back in a short amount of time. And those problems that had to be solved along the way were solved in the end by designing a critical tool like procurement in a particular way that was fixed price, not cost plus, challenge-oriented with incentives for quality improvement and innovation. And in the contracts for the procurement, which was critical to NASA, they even put no excess profits. In other words, being confident of their own role, right? We're gonna do this together. There's collective value creation. It's not just happening in the private sector. It's also in the public sector. And we're gonna make sure it doesn't turn into a gambling casino that any price can be charged, not just because of the procurement change, but also because it's attention to not make it basically a gambling machine, right? That they're gonna share the risks, share the rewards, share the bounty, share the burden, share the bounty, as your prime minister often says. And I'll come back to that in a minute. So this attention that the design of the partnership would only happen if a particular tool, and they then used many different tools as well, was super interesting. And the same guy, Ernest Brackett, said, and if we continue to outsource our brains, because at the time there was a lot of outsourcing already starting to happen in the 1960s from the government public service, he said, we won't even know how to work with the private sector. He never said we shouldn't work with the private sector. He said in order to get 400,000 people, which is what they were doing, to get to the moon and back, government itself had to be investing within its brain. And he warned, if we keep outsourcing, and he was seeing what was happening already with McKinsey at the time, a large consulting company that was actually set up in the 1920s, he said ultimately we will get captured by brochuremanship. Which is quite endearing, because at the time they didn't have the fancy PowerPoints that I'm using now, but they had nice shiny brochures that companies might come in and say, work with us, we know what we're doing and we'll help you, you know, get to the moon or whatever that mission might be. And he said, we won't even know how to select companies. We won't know how to write the terms of references, the contracts, if we ourselves don't have a brain. So this idea of collective value creation, meaning that all the different actors in the system need a brain in order to also work well together and to have a healthy, edgy, dynamic relationship between the two instead of what a biologist would call perhaps a parasitic relationship. So really what we've been doing in the institute that I run, I'm very honored to have Sarah Doyle here, my head of policy, has been actually to work with a select group of countries that are ambitious, that are trying to steer economic growth instead of just growth for growth's sake, and to ask what would it look like if this idea of outcomes orientation, mission orientation, was actually at the heart of how we design our capitalist system. What does it mean for the design of policies, the design of institutions like public banks, the design of tools like procurement that I've already mentioned? What does it mean for new types of social contracts that truly share the burden, share the bounty, share risks, share rewards, but also the essential issue of who makes the decisions in the first place, who decides what the missions are for the space race? Obviously, that's very different from the kind of missions that we are interested in today that need to be underlying our 17 sustainable development goals. How to really bring true, not tokenistic citizen participation, true social partnerships, and not just a box-ticking exercise. So my remaining 12 or so minutes, I just want to give you a sense of the concreteness of this idea, because it does need to be guided by that big thinking of market shaping our economies, talking about the direction of growth, not just the rate of growth, but it also then has to land on the tools, the grants, the loans, the subsidies, the public-private partnerships, whether it's creating a vaccine or thinking about a renewable energy revolution in a country. So really, let me just kind of take it from ground zero, but I'll speed up on this. But what do I actually mean by a mission-oriented approach? This report that we've done together over the last year has it in the title, A Mission-Oriented Strategy for Inclusive and Sustainable Economic Growth in Barbados. It's not just mission, you know, the word mission, the word vision, that can lead to just anyone calling something a mission, right? Trump's wall between the US and Mexico was a mission, keep the immigrants out, right? So what do we mean by mission-oriented design of a policy? It needs to start with a broad challenge, right? And we have the Sustainable Development Goals. Let's not rethink that. What they actually mean in a country, what they mean in a city, what they mean in a parish. I've worked a lot with my own parish, Camden Council in London, using a mission-oriented approach. What that actually means for a place needs to be negotiated. But let's just start with these challenges and assume that they are somehow inspired by the Sustainable Development Goals. Transforming them into missions that are concrete, that you actually can answer, yes or no, did you achieve it? Did you get to the moon and back in a short amount of time? Versus what Greta Thunberg and many teenagers have been telling us that we've been blah, 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 bullshitting, basically, about the Sustainable Development Goals. We talk and talk and talk about inclusive growth, sustainable growth, poverty, hunger, climate, and then don't do anything. Also because it's kind of hard to measure whether you've done something if you just stay at that very broad challenge level. So turning each and every one of the Sustainable Development Goals into missions that you can actually answer yes or no, did you achieve them? But doing so in a way that requires the whole economy to change. This is not about just handing out a lot of money to renewable energy, for example, if you have a climate mission. You know, getting to the moon and back was not just aerospace. Climate change cannot just be done with energy. It requires changing what we eat, how we move, how we build, right? The steel sector can become less carbon intensive than it currently is. So really transforming the whole economy. So that intersectoral approach. But then paying attention to the design of the tools to really catalyze that bottom-up experimentation, because if this is top-down, it will kill innovation, it will kill entrepreneurship, hence it will kill growth. So a clear direction, intersectoral, with bottom-up experimentation, right? Those hundreds, if not thousands, of homework problems that got us to the moon, even if they had blown up just before getting to the moon, it would still have been successful because of how the careful design of the policy actually catalyzed so much experimentation, welcoming the underlying uncertainty versus this old speak about just de-risking someone else. And so what I did with the reason the European thing is here is I actually first worked on this with the European Commission. On the back of that, Europe today has 5 mission areas. There's a missions instrument as part of the 100 billion euro horizon scheme. And it was very interesting to work with the commission because, you know, this part was the easy bit, right? Kind of mapping out different kind of missions of what they might look like. So they landed on these 5 mission areas, including clean growth in cities, oceans, clean oceans. What does that mean to actually get 90% of the plastic out in the next 5 years? What does it mean for all these different sectors and different type of projects that would be part of that catalyzation of bottom-up experimentation, but also it would absolutely then require rethinking the European instruments themselves, like the European Investment Bank, like the innovation strategy, and also making sure that these missions were at a higher level than any ministerial body within the European Commission. And I can't say that actually happened. The missions themselves remained in the DG for innovation and research, which is where they were born. They never actually rose up to the cabinet level, which is where the Green Deal of von der Leyen, the commissioner of the European Union, works. Oh, anyway, she's the head of the European Union. We also work very closely with the UN Economics Commission for Latin America, CEPAL or ECLAC, depending how you pronounce it in English or Spanish, and what this would mean for a Latin American and Caribbean strategy, and also focusing on some countries that have been afflicted by the natural resource curse, For example, in Argentina today, they have lithium, which is great for batteries, but if they continue just to extract, whether it's copper in Chile, lithium in Argentina, without actually making these sectors, which are natural resource sectors, part of a mission, which is to lead to more inclusive and sustainable growth, then something that actually looks good because it's needed becomes part of your problem. In fact, the extraction of lithium from the ground is incredibly water intensive and is also leading to lots of pollution. So always not thinking in terms of sectors, but in terms of the goal and making sure we ask what does it mean for that sector to be part of that solution as opposed to continuing to be part of the problem or a new problem. You solve a problem here and create a problem there. In fact, if you look at the 17 goals, they haven't really been looked at systemically, and sometimes the solution to one goal actually creates a problem on another goal. So that need to also think systemically. And this was really where the Prime Minister and I started to talk about what might a mission-oriented program look like in Barbados. And it was actually incredibly interesting to start hosting those conversations, but then really what the Prime Minister and her government have done with the social partnerships is they've worked very hard in the last year to come up with 6 mission statements, which can, if implemented, and we're at the stage, as she was telling me last night, of starting the implementation phase after a very deliberate execution phase, of what does it then mean for doing things differently? What does it mean for actually changing, for example, how the public and the private sectors work together? What does it mean for actually bringing in citizen engagement into the design of the policies themselves? What does it mean for actually also being able to test what kind of partnerships we have? And I won't read out these 6 different mission areas. I think you might have hopefully been sent the report as you signed up for this conference. But what's very important in all of these is asking, think back to that mission map. What does it mean for starting with those challenges, having the missions, how to bring in as many different sectors together, and then changing the tools or political economic tools to really catalyze that bottom-up experimentation. And so if you look at, for example, the one about starting with that unhealthy planet in crisis, turning it into a mission to become a clean and beautiful large ocean state, not a small island state, championing sustainable development locally and globally with the goal of all domestic activities becoming 100% sustainable by 2025, and really thinking what it means for all sectors. So instead of thinking of tourism as a key sector critical to Barbados, which of course it is, the question becomes what is the role of the tourism sector to help achieve that goal? What are the different types of conditionalities, new contracts between the hotels and different types of public policies in order to make sure that those hotels themselves are training, staff are transforming how they themselves build, are thinking about repurpose, recycle, reuse throughout the whole supply chain of the tourism sector. And of course, this isn't just about the hotels and tourism, but the whole, again, supply chain. And what does it mean to also have principles along the way? And these principles were incredibly important outcomes of this stakeholder consultation and the workshops that were held around the missions. Think of this almost as like a human rights approach, which is something that we're doing with some housing policies in Spain. You might have a housing for all mission, but how do we make sure that a human rights approach, and we have a declaration of human rights globally, by the way, that is hardly ever used for the legal accountability of the design of the interactions, but it was very interesting to see how certain principles were agreed on in terms of these 6 missions around making sure that along the way, these interactions between the sectors and the bottom-up experimentation, the public-private citizenship relationships were also bounded by principles of safeguarding and promoting Barbados's culture and identity, enfranchising workers and reducing poverty, encouraging innovation and digitalization, keeping Barbados healthy and safe, leveraging geography as a logistics hub, share the burden, share the bounty. These are horizontals that have to be paid attention to in the same way that NASA itself was paying attention to contract design early on. Deteriorating physical and mental health and pockets of social instability. I have the honor of having worked at least a bit with Corey Lane, Minister Corey Lane, thinking about crime from a social and economic determinants of crime lens, instead of just policing or more criminal justice in the court system, how to actually redefine justice and think about the social and economic determinants of health, social and economic determinants of crime at the center of this particular mission. Super quickly, because I'm 6 minutes, 5 minutes, I'm out of time, I really want to just play out a bit of the how, right? Because if now we have these six fantastic, inspirational missions in Barbados, again, that came about through the government's own activity with the different social partners and also consultation at workshops. What does it then mean to do this in a way that kind of makes sense, that it doesn't just become a shopping list, right? A new way to talk about old policies but with new words, right? Which is not what we want. If the old policies haven't worked, if the old business governance hasn't worked, if that relationship hasn't worked, how do we make sure this isn't just another sexy word that we come up with to do more of what we were already doing that didn't work? Firstly, really critical to make sure that we do what I just mentioned the European Commission hasn't necessarily done yet, which is to put these missions at a much higher level than any one particular department within government, right? So it has to be both cross-sectoral, so economy-wide, but also making sure that these are missions that really guide economic growth, coming back to the point that growth has a direction, right? Not just a rate. And so that can only really happen if they sit above some sort of at the cabinet level, at the presidential, at the prime ministerial level. And it's really interesting actually looking at the Tarif's mission, which I think we can actually call that in terms of how it's started to interact with these ideas, on how by definition it would actually require the Department of Housing, the Department of Energy, the departments that are actually thinking about biodiversity, cross-cutting, so roof to reefs in terms of the infrastructure, the housing, the roofs, as part of a coordinated, aligned project that thinks about climate resilience and the sustainable use of water resources across different types of social and physical infrastructure. But really then what is critical is thinking about what's the institutional change. Recently I argued with the United Nations that, for example, there's lots of money out there. We just haven't thought about it in a mission-aligned way, in an outcomes-oriented way. Countries have procurement budgets. They're not thought about in an outcomes-oriented way. But they also have development banks. There's $22.2 trillion in national development banks globally. There's $2.2 trillion in multilateral development banks. But they're just kind of, putting financing in different areas, including for SME financing, small, medium enterprise financing. But if it's not actually designed in such a way to solve problems, then the problem is you also start thinking of small companies are worthy of getting money just because they're small versus whether they are willing, so from picking the winners to picking the willing to work with governments around particular problems. And if you're small, you'll need extra support because you're small, but it's not just because you're small that you get that support. So putting also conditionality at the center of public banks. So it's fascinating that the reason that we have green steel in Germany is that the local public bank there, the KfW, put the loan to the steel sector, which globally is asking for help, conditional on that sector reducing the material content of production, which they did through repurpose, reuse, recycle, not because they went to Davos, but because they had to get 1 cent out of the government. So conditional finance, but not the old conditionalities that reduce the fiscal space, actually conditionality based on investment in expanding productive capacity, but capacity in such a way that helps direct an economy in a better direction. In Scotland, I helped set up the Scottish National Investment Bank. Again, really thinking about we need patient finance, not inpatient finance, but how do we make sure that that patient long-term finance is going to those small, medium, also sometimes large companies that are willing and able to work with the government around a digitalization strategy, around a net zero strategy, around any strategy that the government actually, along with its partners, decide is important. It was very interesting to work with Camden on the local Camden Wealth Fund in this spirit, because what's interesting with wealth funds or public banks is actually, by definition, they can be thinking in the same type of institution about wealth creation and wealth distribution at the same time through that one type of institution, if done in such a way that is, again, trying to direct finance, not just fill financing gaps, the structure of the finance, patient, long-term, but also directed finance. Lastly, I really want to just mention a bit more this issue of, well, actually not lastly, this, and then also the issue of the social partnership. You know, procurement, for example, government purchasing is often 30, sometimes 40% of government budgets. And as I mentioned, it was used, you know, it was the first change that the Apollo program made. Well, what would it mean to actually start thinking about all the different social services we have, or public services we have, public transport, public housing, public education in a, keeps going too fast, in an outcomes-oriented way. So in Camden, for example, where the clean growth mission was nested within 10 housing estates, two big innovations they did, first of all, was to bring people living in the housing estates to the table to talk about the mission, so the resident associations, but also then to really think about the services that often happen around a housing estate and to actually bring people who were experiencing the services but also designing the services in terms of social care services, and we worked specifically around adult social care and some of these housing estates, and how to make sure that the care was as ambitious, the quality of the care, the way to even think about the different characteristics that we use to care for people in social housing in a way that would actually then help to design the characteristics of the procurement contracts themselves. And it really required a lot of shaking up of that. Also, what does it mean to think about the data commons, digitalization, not just as a tech fix, but again, as an important tool to really help government work interministerially, but also do what, this is from the city of Barcelona in Spain, also think about citizen empowerment, citizen data, the data commons is how Ada Colau, the mayor of Barcelona, talked about it, in terms of also creating a less intermediated space, so the data when we create it, we create data all the time, then helps the city itself make better decisions for improving public housing, public transport. And it was very interesting, she actually opened a call for the hackers in the computer and software industry to apply to the city government in order to kind of hack the system, how to make sure that as data is created, it has a much less intermediated way to actually improve citizens' lives. And for all of this, we need capacity and capabilities. That's why I wrote this book on the problems of the consultification of our governments, and also a report we did with UNDP, which looked at what were the capabilities necessary for countries to actually work proactively, govern proactively, solve problems proactively during COVID. And it was adapting and learning, aligning public services with citizen needs, like that example I just gave, governing data and digital platforms, inter and intra-governmental learning and coordination, governing resilient production systems. We found that places like Kerala in India, Vietnam, Togo, Rwanda, based on experience they had actually had, which were followed by investment within the public administration in an outcomes-oriented way. It wasn't necessarily missions, but it was an outcomes thinking based on the problems they had had with previous viruses were absolutely critical to their own ability to adapt. And also, in order to do this, it's not easy, as I said in the beginning, it's not a linear pathway, actually setting up some safe places where governments can actually try things out. Again, we're doing it not because it's hard, not because it's easy, but because it's hard means you need to be able to experiment. You need to be able to embrace uncertainty. We, you know, compliment venture capitalists for being risk-taking finance, and then as soon as a civil servant takes risks and fails, we, you know, front page of the newspapers. Whereas if you speak to any venture capitalist, they'll tell you that for each success, there was 8 or 9 failures. So what does it mean to actually embed that spirit of experimentation within government? It's very hard to do without those safe places to be a bit crazy. So Gov Labs, el Laboratorio de Gobierno in Chile. And this is super lastly, the social contract, very important. This keeps going too fast. What does that mean for that symbiotic, mutualistic ecosystem, public-private partnership? This is something that was absolutely central to the discussions we had here, sharing the burden, sharing the bounty. Missions require new relationships between all value-creating actors, right? It's not about value in the private sector, de-risk, facilitated, enabled by the public sector, but really recognizing all the different actors in the system, and then also actually thinking about what would it mean to create a functional partnership between the actors. It was interesting in the United States now with this huge IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act, but also the CHIPS Act. We work closely with the Secretary of Commerce, Gina Raimondo, and how do you make sure that a moment like CHIPS Act, let's bring sovereignty of chips production in the US, becomes a way to do capitalism differently. So conditionality that the semiconductor companies benefiting from a $300 billion program actually treat their workers better, invest in better working conditions, use green supply chains, and don't just engage and also enlarge dividend payouts and share buybacks. It was interesting in COVID that some countries also implemented some of this thinking. In the UK, we gave $600 million to our airline EasyJet, no conditions attached, whereas in France, the support that was provided to Renault and Air France was conditional on those companies committing to reducing their carbon emissions. And again, really interesting learning here in Barbados, where the Barbados Employment and Sustainable Transformation Program really thought hard about this type of conditionality as well. The $300 million to the tourism sector was actually conditional on employee re-engagement and training, greening and digitalizing investment plans, equity investments, monitoring and compliance, and we've been learning a lot from the experience of this program in terms of where the bottlenecks were, the resistance to it, but this is really the way to actually set up those symbiotic partnerships. I promise this actually is the last slide. I'm purposely not looking at Noveline because she said don't talk more than 30 minutes and I'm at 38. So I promise to end in 30 seconds. Participation. Don't ask an economist what that means. We have no idea. but it is absolutely incredibly important. My own experience in my parish was fascinating on that. As I mentioned, not just bringing resident associations to the table for the housing clean growth housing mission, but also, for example, changing food banks, which went up because we have rising inequality in London, but into food cooperatives, green food cooperatives. So the people benefiting from programs are also in charge of the decision making. Again, super interesting, the conversations we had here, both with the different businesses, with the trade unions. A huge honor was meeting a Sir Roy Trotman. I don't know if Tony's here. Is Tony here? No? I was hoping. No. Yes? Where? Tony, okay. Put your picture of you here. But also today with the central bank, and again, huge opportunity. How do you say? Pleasure having being able to host Minister Corey Lane, who came to London also to have some of this discussion of what it actually means to participate. For example, with the crime mission that we were discussing, the comparison with London's own crime problem. Huge knife crime problem amongst the youth. What does it mean to actually bring the youth to the table? We were just talking about this before the talk began. So talking with people leading youth centers, talking about families who've actually had sons, it's mainly sons, who have been both victims but also perpetrators of knife crime. So bringing families to the table, different types of social programs that are dealing with youth on the front lines, bringing their voices to the table. So this idea of voice, it's absolutely central, changing the vocabulary, changing the stories we're telling of where value creation comes from. In the Institute, we always cross out words that we find incredibly problematic. And perhaps the word I should bring up is to say the end. Otherwise, I will go on. I'm purposely not looking at Noveline. Where is she? She said, you cannot go over 30 minutes. I have. But now we get to discuss with the Prime Minister and hopefully some Q&A. So thank you so much to you all for listening to me.
And thank you very much, Professor, for that. You're good. All good. Yes. Thank you so much for that very provocative lecture. Please join us over here for the conversation. And it is also my distinct honor to invite the Prime Minister of Barbados to join us for this conversation, Prime Minister Motley. It's a pleasure. I'm great. And you? So good to see you. So we have a few housekeeping rules before we get started. I'm going to start the conversation, and then I will allow you to pose your questions. I ask that you be as succinct as possible, 15 seconds, if you can make it in 15 seconds, because we wish to accommodate as many questions as possible this evening. So welcome, Prime Minister, and thank you so much, Professor Mazzucato. I feel... must be my Spanish and Italian from school days. I feel privileged to be sharing this stage with two of the world's most phenomenal women. Welcome again. Prime Minister, we want to start with you, and you have outlined six bold missions. Why these six? And how do you see us helping this country at this juncture and creating a sustainable future for their children? I'm saying their because I don't have any, their grandchildren and their great-grandchildren.
Thank you very much, Noeline. And let me first of all congratulate you, Mariana, for what once again has been a compelling lecture. I describe Mariana as a force of nature. And if you work around her enough, you will understand that I don't know anybody else who is as determined, passionate, and capable of achieving as she has been, and generating as much as she has across as many sectors. Look, the missions that we have settled are not mine or are not the government's. They come as a result of consultation across sectors, across the social partnership, labor movement, private sector, civil society, and they come as a result of us understanding the context of the difficulties which we face. It's a lot of long words and a lot of long talk, but what are we really saying? That Barbados, one, must have a clean society both on land and in the oceans, and that we must be able to benefit from those resources on land and in the oceans. Two, that you gotta look in the mirror, as Mr. Barris say, and like who you see. Because if you don't have confidence in yourself, you're not gonna be able to propel the country or propel yourself in the various directions that you need to go. That people must be able to eat food and drink water, because without food and water, you ain't gonna last very long. Four, that we must be able to reduce poverty in this country by ensuring that we do what? Enfranchise people, educate people, empower people. Five, that we must be able to improve our health and well-being in this country and our safety. So Barbadians must be safe and Barbadians must be healthy. And then finally, that we live in a world where this thing, this technology thing is controlling so much of what we're doing that we must be able to transition our country to be able to be conversant in a digital world and to use the technology in a way that benefits us overall. So it's a lot of long words, but that's what it really comes down to. Can we achieve it overnight? Absolutely not. Are we, however, in a position where we can see appreciable progress between now and 2030? We must. And why? Because people have choices about where they go, where they invest, what they do. And similarly, our people have choices about if they stay here or if they leave. And this country has traditionally exported people from as far back as the 19th century. And what we're finding is that unless we give people a reason to stay here, we're going to be even more challenged. You saw Mariana say that she did some work for CELAC. And CELAC has predicted, as I keep saying, that by the year 2050, Barbados is going to have a situation where one in every two people will be over the age of 65. I've cited over and over where we were in 1950 at 200,000 people compared to Belize and Bahamas at 80,000. Both of those countries now have in excess of 400,000, and in fact, rather than going up, since 2010, our population has declined in actual numbers to 267. You perhaps see it more, and I noticed it more, having been a Minister of Education 30 years ago, and presiding over the numbers for common entrance, there were about 4,200 people a year. We're down now to 3,200 a year. And the live births, people in the primary school, we're down to 2,200 a year. So that this thing is literally contracting at a rate that is unsustainable. Sir George has given, I believe, a lecture in this same hall, it may have been the Errol Barrow lecture, when he spoke about the aging society that we have. And what we effectively have is an aging society and a contraction in numbers as the persons who are productive citizens working day in, day out. We can't survive as a nation if we allow that to become our future. And along the way, we need to be able to deal with the things that will give us the best chance, even as we try to deal with that major problem of lack of population. And these missions, in our view, if every Bajan can look in the mirror and see the person that they like and believe in the person and not carry a chip or a quarry on the shoulder, then we are in a position to be able to make sure that we can extract maximum value from our people. If we can ensure that the number of people who are suffering from chronic NCDs or who may have to retire early from the public service can be reduced, once again, we pay out less in benefits and more productivity. If we can digitize more, then we can ensure, for example, that we can do far more in a shorter space of time. If we can educate our children differently, if we can get rid of the educational apartheid that has governed this country for over 70 years and value each and every child and value them for their abilities, and we learned during COVID, it wasn't the people who were pushing paper that you needed the most, it was the people who was pushing garbage carts and people who were pushing trolleys in hospitals and people who were doing all the other things that the society can't function without. And that's why the government is still committed to a University College of Barbados, because the training in applied arts and sciences will make the difference to labor. And if we can do all of that while making sure, if you can't get a food every day, you can't get access to water, how are you gonna move? How are you gonna get yourself focused on doing the things? So these things are written here for those who have to work in the bureaucracy and those who have to across public sector, labor movement, and the private sector, but really and truly they have to be broken down in the way that I just broke it down, so every household in this country understands that they have a role to play in making this country a place that is better for them, and by extension, this country a place that can command the attention, the investment, and the participation of others outside of Barbados, because without that, we will not see the direction of growth, and we will not have the level of inclusive growth that will keep us safe and sound in this nation.
Well said. Mariana touched on it in her lecture, but help us understand the importance of your huge initiative, the Bridgetown Initiative, in advancing these missions, Prime Minister.
Largely because, look, let's take 2021, April 9th, ash fall, after we said that we could come out from December 31st lockdown. There were those who made jokes and said that we had a pact with the gods, because the day, the weekend you were to come out, the ash come and keep you in. Then that was April 9th. By the middle of June, we were facing a freak storm. And by the beginning of July, the 3rd of July, the first hurricane since Janet, Hurricane Elsa. All of that, the governor would tell you, would have resulted in additional expenditure that we would not have been looking for. And when we look at that and we look at the consequences of the pandemic, what we had to do was to borrow for things that were beyond our control. And if you accept that in many instances, the climate crisis is driven, the climate crisis is driven by the developed world, and that 80% of the cause of it is largely because of the developed world. Where does that leave us with the SDGs? Where does that leave us with getting people to school? Where does that leave us with improving our health system? Where does that leave us with improving our infrastructure and our coasts? How many people go down to Six Men's? How many people remember Six Men's in the days when people lived on the beachside and below the houses, as the men remind us, people used to play cricket between the house and the shoreline and where the water break. Now the water breaking where the men lime in and where the stalls are on the road. So that in order for us to fix these things, we need fiscal space. Later this week, I go to COP. And it's going to be a critical one, because at the end of the day, no matter how much money you put in front of us, Mariana would tell you, if we don't have the fiscal space, we can't get there. And if we have to commit to being able to bring debt down by a certain time, that puts us in trouble in terms of what we can spend, even if we have the money, as the governor would tell you. The reality is that the Bridgetown Initiative says, look, there have been some assumptions that you guys have been making First of all, you've crafted these institutions at a time when we didn't exist. So you don't understand our circumstances. Secondly, you need to pause and recognize, how could you ask Dominica to pay you back money 2 weeks after Hurricane Maria, when people couldn't even find somewhere to put their heads down or to get food, but they're now looking to give you tens of millions of dollars at the very time when they should have been looking to protect people? Because the last time I checked, none of us have the capacity to give back life to anybody who is dead. Thirdly, that we need therefore to recognize that those debt pause clauses, that they now call them, we call them natural disaster, but like with most things, when it comes from our part of the world, it's renamed in the image of another. So they're now called debt pause clauses. And effectively what it does is to give you the space at a time when our societies are underinsured and uninsured in large measure. We also make the point that I talked about the debt sustainability just now, and they did so in a way that started to ease some of the pressure. But think of how much more could have been done if the countries who really needed the money could get it, rather than the countries who didn't need the money getting 2/3 of the special drawing rights. And that's fundamentally the problem. And when you look at when special drawing rights were included, you're talking about 1969, at a time when the world, some of the same countries were not even independent in those days. So we're taking on a lot of these issues, and there are more. But we're taking on them frontally in the Bridgetown Initiative, because at the end of the day, we can't function in a polycrisis without some elbow room, some fiscal space, and some policy space. And if you don't see me and you don't know my circumstances, you can't provide for us. And all the Bridgetown Initiative did, and Mariana, I thank you for being part of that initial consultation with so many others who gathered here. It was crop over weekend last year. And while others were fetting, we were also working and fetting, trying to craft the Bridgetown Initiative. And it has certainly made a difference in how people understand that you can't ask me only to raise money for climate and forget people, and that people and planet have to be the center of all that we do. We now see the new president of the World Bank talking about ensuring that they can remove poverty, build prosperity on a livable planet, at a time when the previous president of the World Bank denied that the climate crisis was real. So these things, fortunately for us, have helped to move the needle.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. I would like to bring in the professor now. And of course, these are humongous initiatives, huge missions. Help us understand how we manage the risk and the governance around them.
So it's a great question, but I think we also have to remember that governments already do a lot. The problem is that the sum is not bigger than the parts. Missions actually help to bring a focus and an alignment in the way that government is already working with different actors, but actually not helping to solve the greatest challenges that people are living in those countries. So sometimes I hear, for example, the question, well, what does what you're talking about mean for whether it's a small island state, a small country? It's even more important if you actually have less fiscal space. And part of the fiscal space that Mia Motley is talking about, the Prime Minister is talking about, is the unjust fiscal space. That fiscal space has often been engineered to be much smaller than it should be. But in countries also that are just smaller, they also just have less, if you want, capacity and resources, it's even more important, right, to make sure that there's more bang for the buck. So if you think of what the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres talks about as the SDG multiplier, the concept of the multiplier, of course, came from Keynes, right? John Maynard Keynes, who after the Great Depression kind of woke people up and said, guess what? It's not just this depression. Countries have had depressions, proper depressions, basically for every 10 to 15 years leading up to the Great Depression. And he said, it's not rocket science. If everyone cuts back in bad times, consumers are spending less, businesses are investing less, if government also is pro-cyclical, then you get recessions, which happen, you know, just, I don't want to say naturally, because there's nothing natural, but anyway, recessions turn into depressions. So we started to have counter-cyclical investment only after the kind of Keynesian revolution. And then this concept of the multiplier was talked about, which is for every pound, dollar, peso of government money, how much does it actually catalyze in the economy in terms of GDP growth? And we have these fancy equations in economics, but the way the multiplier actually happens, the spending rounds, the investment rounds, so with public investment in an area, does that actually then catalyze more spending and investment in other areas? What missions do is they really speed up that catalytic role, because if you actually have a vision on net zero, for example, in a region, in a city, in a country, and you make sure that every penny that government is spending, coming back to whether it's procurement, grants, or loans, is conditional on others working with you to solve that problem. And if you also have a public bank, instead of doing what Italy's public bank does, and I'm allowed to insult Italy because I'm Italian, don't let any German sit up here and insult Italy, the Italian public bank historically has just given out money to any sector that's in trouble. Help, help, I'm in trouble. Well, first of all, why are you in trouble? Have you been investing in the past? Have you been also investing in your workforce in the past? And if you want government support, let us help you transform so you're not in trouble again later. So that idea of actually having, as I mentioned, the German public bank put conditions on the steel loan to make steel more competitive, more green, more modern, actually ultimately helped growth, helped make that sector more competitive. But it was, you know, the way it happened was not just talking about competition, not just talking about innovation and growth, but really paying attention to that contract, right? So I think this is where it becomes interesting. How do we use every opportunity that governments have? And the only reason we're here talking about governments is, of course, because what this is about is also changing policy and partnerships to actually foster that catalytic, multiplier effect, which can actually then transform an economy. And surprise, surprise, it actually causes growth. I don't know any country that has achieved growth by talking about growth. And what was so interesting, again, with the Apollo program is all those different examples, the camera phone, the foil blankets, the baby formula, were technologies that no one thought about as ends in themselves. No one said, we need software for the sake of software. Software was a result of what they needed to get to the moon. The internet was a result of needing to know how to get the satellites to communicate. GPS and all our smartphones was a solution to a publicly set problem. So using problems in a society to then have purpose-oriented and problem-oriented policies then catalyzes public and private sector investment, and then surprise, surprise, you get growth. But that's because you put problems at the center as opposed to just giving out money to sectors that beg for support.
So I actually wanted to come in here because the truth is that we had ways of setting conditions in the past, but we forgot it. So in 1952, Grantley Adams brought a piece of legislation to Parliament called the Labor Clauses Public Contracts Act, which basically said that if you wanted to benefit from government contracts, you had to ensure that workers benefited from certain minimum conditions in the workplace. It has become topical again for us post-COVID, particularly with the construction industry, now with the hotel industry, because we recognize that there has to be a floor below which nobody goes. Now, since public contracts, it wasn't only that. We spend in tax expenditures, our tax expenditures this year, will be in the vicinity of $750 million. Now, that is a significant amount of money to give up in concessions. The majority of it goes to tourism, but some goes to agriculture, some goes to different other sectors in the economy. And we're simply saying that, look, if government is going to do these things, as we said with the BEST program, which had challenges, but I'm a Jimmy Cliff girl, as is the government. We can get it if we really want, but you're going to try and try and try. We'll succeed at last. And we're finding that both there and in the housing program. Why? Because at the end of the day, when we said in the BEST program, hotels in Barbados need to be able to justify the average daily rate that they charge, which means that the experience has to be one where people find that it is competitive and you will go back to it. If you're going in a hotel where the furniture is dated or popped down, are you likely to go back? Are you going into a hotel where the processes and the technology is all analog and the people can't respond in quick order? Can we justify in a planet crisis, in a crisis for the planet and in a country that is water scarce, having practices that cause us to use far more water than we need to be using? So we said, look, in the BEST program. And I want to remind the country of this, because people forget that in the middle of 2020, we came to the brink in this country with respect to bankruptcy of both the tourism sector and the severance payments fund. And we had to call everybody in a room and say, okay, just as we did in 2018 to save the dollar, where we had a whole of nation approach, where everybody had to agree to take a little sacrifice, I need the country now, the workers, the employers, and everybody. So here's what's gonna happen. The workers, we asked you to allow us to amend the Severance Payments Act in order to ensure that hotels would not become bankrupt by having to face extraordinarily high severance payments bill purely by reason of the affliction of time as a result of a pandemic over which we had no control. Two, we then said to hotels, look, we understand that you will have problems with dilapidation if you don't at least open up, because you don't flush toilets every day, you don't open up windows, tiles can blow, all kinds of madness will start to happen. We will help those of you who need help on condition one, that you start to look at training the workers again. Now, to that we've added the kind of minimum conditions that they must benefit from. Two, that you need to green, because at the end of the day, if Barbados does not have a green tourism sector, we're not going to be, one, either consistent with the country's commitment to net zero, but two, you're not going to be able to function in its new world where more and more people are demanding that you have policies that reflect their commitment to save the planet on which we live. Three, that you need to be able to digitize. You can't be going to check in a hotel and still writing down with pen and paper when in truth and in fact, everything else can be controlled by technology to be able to bring about greater efficiency. And four, you don't live in this country alone. So let me talk about procurement practices now. Your hotels can't be wearing and having no art up or no art that is from about here. Nobody can tell you that you must buy paintings that are excessive cost, but at least buy prints that reflect our culture. Secondly, agriculture. Stop giving people juice out of tins when they got so much youngsters about here who picking fruit and making juices when the day come, and let us get them to work with BNSA and produce the drinks for you, so that when somebody comes to the Caribbean, they expect to get a truly tropical experience and not something that's in a tin. And thirdly, that in addition to your agriculture, and your artwork, and performing arts, that we also look at the manufactured things by Beijing, because that way you're then securing a platform for your local industry and ensuring that we can all benefit. Now, I say this because if you want to benefit from public money, you've got to carry along your brothers and sisters, and this is the only way we're going to do it. Did we have resistance from some? Yes, and too much. But we have to reach the point now where we understand that you can't be spending. If we weren't giving out $750 million in concessions, we'd be collecting over $4 billion. So you're effectively talking about just under a quarter of the government's revenue going in concessions, because that is how we've done it traditionally. We also give incentives and concessions. Tom Adams introduced the concessions for tax credits, tax allowances, for the solar water heaters. That's why Barbados has a higher level of penetration for solar water heaters than most developing countries and some developed countries. Similarly, he did it for the credit union movement. So we now have a credit union movement that is a significant savings base in the country that might not otherwise have been there. There are benefits, and we've been doing it for a while, but in recent times, in the last two decades or so, we became very laissez-faire in terms of how we engaged with the rest of the community and the rest of the sectors, rather than building out in a purposeful way according to the missions that we've set.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. We want to open up the conversation now to you, the members of the audience who've been listening all evening. Remember, just raise your hand, and when I identify you, please ask your question very succinctly. But I acknowledge this gentleman over here, but before I go to him, we have a few questions coming in via Slido, and we need to be a little bit more succinct. Panelists, thank you. Given the issues of scale and the outward migration of expertise. Thank you very much.
But I also want to send the message tonight.
And you are doing that very well. Expertise, capacity/innovation. How would you tackle market shaping to encourage sustainable growth? Go ahead, Professor.
First of all, one of the things that we sometimes forget is that it's actually about shaping the whole economy, right? So one of the most inspirational moments for me recently in working with the country was when in Sweden they put this idea of market shaping emissions, not in this kind of separate part of the economy where you might talk about, you know, innovation as an end in itself, but at the center of what they called the welfare state. So they said, if we want to have a green economy and an inclusive economy, we in the government have to do what we do, even with public services, differently. So their goal was to have a fossil-free welfare state. And they said, we're going to make it trickle down on everything. So by shaping the economy, it means don't just shape this bit of the economy. Bring it in that horizontal way, coming also back to the principles that were horizontal. And they said, even something like school meals, lunch in schools, could be either mission-oriented or not. And they said precisely by using, you know, by actually having a goal, because it's really about goal orientation. So the market shaping matters if you have goals. If you don't have goals, there's no reason to shape a market, and you can just kind of fix here and there and just hope for the market ultimately to do its thing with a couple patches. And they said school meals have to be healthy, tasty, and sustainable. And all of a sudden, there was an innovation goal on something as simple as school lunch, right? The only reason I talked about the Apollo program was to say we would have never gone to the moon in the way that we do policy today. But I'm actually not talking about space. I'm talking about the everyday. So market shaping is about taking also the everyday, normalizing ambitions, and actually not leaving almost any area behind. And I think the best place for a government to start is where it itself has to change what it's doing, right? So the Swedish government had to change the relationship between the private sector and the school meal provision in that outcomes-oriented way. And what was interesting, it ultimately created a more competitive ecosystem with small and medium local companies, local to the schools, that were providing meals but with an innovation outcome. And they also brought students into it in terms of that participation point that I quickly did in the end. They brought that challenge also to students to help design the meals. They brought that idea of sustainability of lunch. Every kid can't wait for lunch in school, to the curriculum, whether it's biology, mathematics, or literature. So you can kind of, you know, get the sense that this is about really just changing agency, who we actually give power to change. And instead of just saying, oh, we got some food to produce for a school, you make it part of your innovation budget. In the UK, $10 billion is what we spend a year, which, you know, sounds like a lot, but it's not that much if you think about, for innovation. Our innovation budget is $10 billion. Just the procurement budget of the Ministry of Transport is $40 billion. So if you go across the board, if you have this outcomes and shaping mentality, all of a sudden your innovation budget increases exponentially, because everything you do, whether it's in health, education, defense, or transport, has a goal. And then the idea is that you use all your different levers to shape the economy to deliver in a goal-oriented way.
Thank you.
So let me say very quickly, the Ministry of Finance is getting ready to do estimates with all ministries from January. And we sent out a circular basically requiring two things this year to force ministries to come into the estimates process. One is for them to determine where they are meeting the missions that we've agreed to and signed as a social partnership on May 1st this year. And secondly, to be able to deconstruct and reconstruct, because in too many instances we're using age-old concepts. This afternoon we had the Planning and Priorities Committee of Subcommittee of Cabinet dealing with capital projects, and it's been meeting the same way that Tom Adams set it up to meet decades ago. And we said, no, that can't continue in an age when we have technology. And you can't be given dated reports for something that is available to be done in real time when you have Google Sheets and all other kinds of materials. Secondly, I give you the other problem, however, in executing it. When I was Minister of Education, we tried wanting to change what children ate because of chronic NCDs. We were aware of them from as far back as that. And of course, they started, some of the children in the country would eat the provisions, the ones in town wouldn't eat it for hell. They wanted macaroni pie almost every day and all the other things that have turned out to cause us problems in this country. The current Minister of Education has now introduced a nutrition program with schools working together, and we have to stick to it to get it done, because simply we are just having too many problems with healthcare. Largely, there are too many youngsters with type 2 diabetes, and unless we stick to it in terms of changing how we eat, then we're not going to solve that problem. But as we do that, then obviously the farmers in this country will start to smile, because all of a sudden you have an opportunity for fresh produce going in, and then the chefs will start to smile too, because they can become innovative with respect to the kinds of recipes that the school meals can use, so that you're not just eating breadfruit stretch out or sweet potato roast one way, but you can use it in a way that may be more palatable to the kids to be able to eat. So we'll just give you that example of where we started. Yeah. You didn't even know, because I hadn't shared that with you. But that's where we started. But I am aware that if the families and the homes don't reinforce the message, then all that happens is that a lot of food gets wasted every day, as happened when I was Minister of Education.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. Go ahead, sir, and be quick. Thank you. And then I acknowledge two gentlemen at the back here, and then this lady.
Good evening. Thank you very much, Professor Mazzucato. My question is for you. What does market shaping mean for labor markets in the era of remote work? Particularly, the Prime Minister Motley's government has had some initiatives like the welcome stamp visa and Startwise to get Bajans employed with metropolitan foreign exchange earning jobs. But on a global scale, what does it mean for the global economy, do you think, that people can work in one place and live in another?
Professor?
It's a great question, and it's not a question I have thought profoundly enough to give you a super intelligent answer, but the first part of the question is incredibly important, precisely in thinking about these kind of, you know, shaping of the contract. So I'm glad, again, that Tony's here, because we talked a lot about it when I visited you and when Sir Roy Trotman was there, which is how can we make sure that investment, not just in some of the, you know, areas that we talked about, so better pay and good working conditions, but also the type of work, right? So whether it's remote work, whether it's allowing women who have just had children to have maternity leave, which actually allows them to come back into the workplace in an easier way, how to make sure, you know, in the US, for example, most strikes don't happen over wages, but on being forced to work overtime, right? That you actually don't have, again, the agency on how much you want to work. And so it's this kind of interesting dual situation where we talk about remote work, but that's really for people who in some cases have had the luxury to be able to make those decisions, when actually a lot of the population globally is being forced to work more than they ever have, also having two jobs to make ends meet. So I think, you know, one of the examples that I didn't bring up was actually about Scott Wind, which I know that you're interested in terms of the technology transfer potentially around offshore wind between Scotland and Barbados. But one of the interesting things they've done in Scotland is they have a business pledge, which companies, in order to work with the government, have to kind of satisfy these eight different conditions, one of which has actually increasingly to do with remote work. But the idea behind Scott Wind is that the government will give the rights to companies to use the sea for the offshore wind if they are actually abiding to different types of not only local conditions in order to actually make sure that talent and capital is invested locally, but also good work. You know, what does good work look like? And I think the issue of remote work today is very much part of that definition of what good work is, but these things don't happen on their own. They're negotiated. In the United States, by the way, people don't talk about it enough globally. We've just had one of the biggest, I say we because I have like too many citizenships, American, Italian, and British, so depends where I am when I say we. But one of the biggest strikes ever, right? The United Auto Workers struck against three different companies in the automobile industry, GM, I was going to say Fiat, Chrysler, and Ford. And what was interesting there was the idea that the green transition will only happen if there's a just transition. So green and justness go hand in hand. And so that kind of question becomes central, right? What does it mean to talk about climate and the conditions of work at the same time? And the justice they were going after was the fact that in the battery plants, workers were earning much less than the unionized manufacturing plants. And how do we make sure that the different types of rights, including how much you want to work, maternity and paternity benefits, working conditions, worker pay, are part of how we think about that directionality? So we can't talk about climate, we can't talk about biodiversity, we can't talk about water without actually talking about the work in these different spaces. And how we define good work today, for the reasons you say, is very different from how we defined good work, let's say, 20 years ago. But who's at the table, whose voices are at the table to make sure that those negotiations are, in fact, collective negotations is, I think a very important question.
Thank you. The two gentlemen at the back. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your speech. And I very much enjoyed your book, The New the Entrepreneurial Estate, a few years ago. You mentioned not so long ago two things, bang for the buck and the Keynesian multiplier. And that brings us on to economic models. And I just wonder, where would I find a statement of your economic model? Now, I know that at the moment, because of the 2008 crisis, economists tend to be moving away from models. People like the Greek economist, Yanis Varoufakis, for example, talks a lot about indeterminacy in relationships. The former Bank of England governor, Mervyn King, wrote recently about the radical uncertainty, which is really about all these variables. There's so much uncertainty that it's difficult to run econometric models. So there are three models: an econometric model, a mathematical model, or a computer simulation. Could you tell me where I might find your models and where they've been tested?
Great point. So first of all, Keynes had this great quote, which was that practitioners who think they're just on the ground getting the job done are often slaves of defunct economic theory. So many policies actually are founded on particular assumptions that come from theoretical models that are often implicit and not rendered explicit. So I think the question is very important, which is, if there's a new design of policy, where's the new or old economic thinking that underlies that? And, you know, I think the question, I don't want to say confused the two different areas, but touched on two different areas, which I think we need to separate. One is the quantitative techniques. So in my own work, I do lots of econometrics, lots of computer simulation, and so on. That's not a model. The model is, what is the theory you actually have of the economy? And one of the things that I focus on, for example, in my book, The Value of Everything, is to say, actually, if we want better policy, you need to start with first principles of value theory. So in that book, I looked at how value theory was done in classical political economy, and then what happened when neoclassical political economy, or neoclassical economics, which is a theory, a theoretical paradigm of the economy, started to confuse value with price. So what we put in GDP today is anything that has a price. So if you marry your babysitter, GDP goes down. Be careful. If you pollute, GDP goes up, because you have to pay someone to clean it. So when you start having this tautological relationship between value and price, because the way we actually look at value is also subjective versus object, I mean, I don't want to go into the whole theory, but basically in the book I argue that when we move from an objective theory of value to a subjective theory of value, which we have in modern mainstream economic theory, where everyone is just maximizing their individual utility, consumers, profits, companies, even workers are assumed to be maximizing their choices of leisure versus work, and then you sum up all these individual maximizing decisions and you have your supply and demand curves, and the prices then, equilibrium prices, reveal value. We just have a big problem. We end up not knowing how to talk about value except as outcomes of equilibrium prices. And those who've tried to critique why GDP is a problem have not actually, in my view, critiqued some underlying problems that even the physiocrats in the 1700s, when they were the first theorists ever of economic theory, their goal was to differentiate, for example, value creation activities from value extraction activities. So they called the landlords the sterile class because they were extracting a lot of money out of the system. Sterile because the system would not reproduce itself. We today, in modern neoclassical economic theory, do not properly differentiate something that Adam Smith talked about, Ricardo talked about, Marx talked about, which is the difference between profits and rents, value creation, value extraction. So the work that I've tried to do personally in the theoretical bit is to really put attention back to those first principles of what is value, who is even counted as a value creator, but if the production function is actually, for example, not including value creation from public entities, which are then just coming in to fix market failures, we then need, if we're interested in actually talking about this more proactive design of policy, rethink even the underlying microeconomics. One thing I'm actually writing about right now with a colleague in Berkeley is thinking about a new theory, not just of the firm, right? The theory of the firm is the history of microeconomic theory, but the theory of the public organization. Mm. We don't actually have a theory of state organizations. We have theories of the firm. And that's because we have a theory of value, where businesses have a contribution to value, but if the public sector is just fixing markets, we end up not with a theory of public organizations. So, I mean, the question is very important, but the way we then test these theories, if you just say kind of mathematically, econometrically, computer simulation, ultimately what also happens with the mathematics is what kind of mathematics? Is it from Newtonian physics, as I said before, or do we also bring in mathematics, say, from biology? So distance from mean dynamics is how biologists think about things versus mean dynamics, where we're just looking at averages and representative agents.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Yes, I note with interest that you did not speak about economics as though it were some reified entity somewhere out there, and that you tended to link it with a variety of key factors. Here in Barbados, the major issue facing the nation, in my opinion, I think in Ms. Motley's opinion too, is education reform. And
education.
And the link between education and economic growth is extremely important. In fact, if we look at the Frank Sinatra song, I don't think you can have one without the other. They are two sides of the same coin. But our education system is virtually obsolete. It was based on the old British system, whereby only a handful of persons benefit. I don't want to go into the great details, but just the basics. And I will come to the question. And the majority of the students in Barbados were like barbarians outside the gates. That actually was established in 1871, and it is still the system today. And I note with interest that you mentioned the space project, and really the key behind the space project was also education reform in the United States by Jerome Bruner and persons of that ilk. And so the point I want to make here is that in order for us to get the economic growth, we have to have education reform. And you are from Camden.
Thank you.
In inner London.
You
the question, no, the question is very important.
Okay.
It's very important. You are from Camden in inner London. When I lived in London, I did teaching practice in that area. And at the time, London inner schools were the worst in the country. As a result of education reform, London inner London schools are not only the wonder of Britain in particular, but even outside of Britain. And I want you to comment on what do you think the reason for that change in fortunes between inner London of the past and the change in the education system, which has brought the schools, the inner schools in London with the immigrants, all the blacks that were educationally subnormal and things of that nature, are now the top students throughout the whole of Britain, including the suburbs. I would like you to comment on the relationship between education reform and economic growth.
Thank you.
Very interesting question. And I agree with the basic principles of also what you were trying to get at, which is, first of all, unless we invest in education and educational mm-hmm. reform, not only will we probably not get growth, but if we do get growth, it's the wrong kind of growth. It's a very mm-hmm. unequal form of growth. By the way, we know that it costs less to educate a child than to imprison them, and yet we, in most advanced industrialized countries today, have increased the amount that we're spending on prisons and less on education per capita, and the attention that we're actually thinking about in terms of educational reform in the spirit of what you were talking about is not getting enough attention. In London, I mean, I have four kids, they all went to state schools in London, in Camden. I massively appreciate those schools for the reasons you're saying. The investments that were made in the schools were combined also with a lot of attention, for example, to appreciation around diversity in the schools, value, you know, making each child feel valued in the schools. However, even just in Camden, even just on my street, there's two different schools, two different primary schools, which are in theory given the same amount of money, but they are very, very unequal. I mean, in terms of when you start having certain kids going to one school and other kids all on free school meals in the other school, and people also starting to use the postcode, if you want lottery, to send their kids to one school instead of another, you get segregation. And London definitely has better schools than many schools outside of London, but there's very segregated outcomes, segregated school systems, even in London. And personally, my view would be, A, get rid of private schools, B, make, you know, keep thinking about both London neighborhoods and have planning processes that keep the neighborhoods very diverse. So what London has that's wonderful is that in the same square, you might have a housing estate on the square and, you know, homes that are for people with higher incomes on the same square. So they are much more integrated than in places, say, like New York, where you have much more segregation. And if it becomes that you have to send your kid to the local school instead of all the different gaming that you have going on by just moving to send your kid to a school, and then you have this situation that I talked about before, then, you know, these things are related. So the way to think about schools is not just in terms of the funding, which they often don't have, but how do you actually then prevent this segregated system that we've ended up, because certain families can then move closer to the school that has a higher Ofsted report. That's the reports that they use to judge the schools. The other thing is the actual curriculum. What I find absolutely incredible is that everyone talks about some technical skills in the schools, like, you know, coding and this, that, the other, but the ability to debate, the ability to study philosophy and critical thinking is only in certain types of schools. And so making sure that the national curriculum doesn't itself start to become part of the segregation, which is, again, happening now as we've had austerity for the last 10 years, which types of subjects get cut in across the board, which schools, because they have more money, are able to continue to offer music classes. We often talk about culture, arts classes, debate clubs, critical thinking skills tend to be the schools that also have a higher level of socioeconomic intake. And that's hugely problematic. So I really appreciate the question because it tackles both the resources mm-hmm. that we've seen also invested in London schools, but also that attention to making sure, something that you talk about all the time, that feeling when you told me the story recently when you walked into a school and the kids were looking down and not looking up at you confidently. You also mm-hmm. mentioned confidence before. That is one of the best ways also to fight inequality, making people have that mm-hmm. self-respect and feeling equally valued. But that requires a huge amount of attention. It should be part of the school reform and curriculum reform process.
Thank you. The lady right here. And then we go to Dr. Marion Williams.
Yes, hi, good night. Great talk. I've been enjoying the discussion. I really like the mission approach. I think it's a great, what I would call 21st century way of looking at policy today. I guess my concern for Barbados would be that while it's this very new way of looking at policy, the actual execution doesn't always match in terms of changing our perspective and how we look at things. And for me, the best example of this is probably our approach to health and healthcare, where even how we think about things like non-communicable disorders has changed a lot in the last decade. And
sorry, I missed the word. How we think about what?
Non-communicable disorders and just diseases in general has changed a lot in the last decade, and it keeps changing very, very rapidly. And one of the things that's critical there is updating how we do our life science, looking at biomedicine. It's not so much about looking at just what we feed people, but we have to look at genetics. We have to look at developing new medication. And I know one of the things Barbados is looking at doing is getting into pharmaceutical development. But what we're doing there does not match the kind of updated perspective that's being proposed here with the mission objective. There's no translational framework. There's no consideration of developmental pipelines. It's very, very disconnected from what is being proposed. So my question here is, how do you bridge that gap between this very updated, modern 21st century of looking at policy and the actual execution, which is still very much rooted in 1950s and 60s ways of doing things, including the aspect of public consultation? Because that's critical to the entire process. But for example, we just had a regulatory document come out and be given to government, but the public doesn't have a great idea of what's in that document. We haven't looked at public perspectives on things, even though we know today in 2023 that public opinion is critical when it comes to drug regulation. Because if you create a drug that your people don't use, then you'll have an issue. So it's just, I'm seeing a certain amount of disconnect, and I'm wondering, in the years to come, what is the plan to resolve that? Thank you.
You? Before Mariana goes, perhaps I need to clarify, because you're referring to the white book, ma'am? Right, and the white book is just an indicative guide of the things that have to be done now. And it gives us a scan or an audit of all of those things, which will be the subject of consultation. So for example, the law that we need to come up with is going to have to reflect and to amend or repeal 33 pieces of legislation that we have on the ground. So what we received is not the end result, but what we received is simply the indicative guide towards what we must do. And it's the same thing that Rwanda would have had to have gone through trying to be able to move. What we're trying to do, and most people don't know this, Barbados has been in the business of pharmaceuticals since 1888. And in fact, in 1962, Barbados, was it Carlisle Laboratories, otherwise known as Collins Limited, was doing about 140 fill and finish drugs for us. We want to move to the next stage, and we want to be able to have modern biologics that will allow us to be able to get, and in this particular instance, look at monoclonal antibodies to be able to help us with cancer treatment, rheumatoid arthritis, a lot of the other debilitating diseases. And in most instances, these drugs are not available in the Caribbean, in Central America, and in Latin America. And if they are, the price at which they're available is certainly not for the majority of the people, but just for a very, very thin and small minority. What the pandemic showed us was that this was unsustainable. And therefore, we are working now, in fact, only up to today, I spoke to the Director General of the World Trade Organization, because we're gonna have to also look at opt-in programs for South-South alliances in order to get the scale that is necessary to be able to make these things work. But on your broader point, I want Mariana to answer, because I take that, I just wanted to clarify on the white book, but I take that there is legitimacy in ensuring that our capacity to execute and our capacity to engage with the population changes, because transformation will only come with scale. And what we're very good at doing in Barbados is a little something there and a little something there, and it becomes a wonderful conversation piece. And the kind of transformation, and Mr. Adams, I call it education transformation, because reform is not going to carry us where we need to go. And unless we have scale, we're not going to get the transformation that we need. And regrettably, as a small nation, we can't be playing catch-up anymore. We have to be doing leapfrog. Because if we don't leapfrog, we're not going to be able to withstand the many crises that we're now facing across the world.
Thank Mariana? You, Professor.
Yeah, I mean, maybe just two parts to the question. One on life sciences that you mentioned. I mean, it's interesting, the kind of Barbados' life strategy, which brings together different areas that would include how do we redefine life and the good life. So investment in life sciences and biotech, in the agro-food industry, in tourism, in terms of good tourism, sustainable tourism. And that kind of reminded me when I was talking actually to Mark Hill about it, who I guess is one of the biggest promoters of it, what happened in the UK, which is we have a life sciences sector, which has benefited massively from government support, like life sciences have globally. In the United States, which pretends to be a market-driven model, it's always been a very active, you know, pretend to be invisible hand. There is a visible hand. $40 billion a year of taxpayer money goes towards health innovation in the US. And yet then what is produced doesn't take that into account. So the prices of the drugs don't reflect that. The intellectual property rights are often too wide, just used for strategic reasons, too strong. In other words, hard to license, and too upstream, which is not where patents should be. Patents were not meant to be so upstream so that the tools of research are being privatized. So that's really bad governance, right? A patent is a contract. Unfortunately, they're called property rights, as though the rights come down from God. It's just a contract, and the government is giving the private sector a 17-year monopoly. What does the government get back? You get more dissemination, for example, of the knowledge once the patent is up, but not if you've misgoverned the patents by allowing them, again, to be too wide, too strong, too upstream. So really thinking through, coming back to this collective value creation process, life sciences is the perfect example. Lots of private, large pharmaceuticals, small biotech companies, and government efforts. How do we rethink the life sciences sector in a way that, again, shares the burden, shares the bounty in the way we produce in the first place? And in the UK, the reason I actually got very interested in the challenge-oriented industrial strategy was precisely because sectors like life sciences were being called the key sector. There was life sciences, the creative sector, finance, automotive, and aerospace. And I worked closely with the minister at the time, Greg Clark, who was actually a Tory minister, and yet quite good. And we changed the industrial strategy away from a sector-focused strategy, the industrial strategy, where sectors like life sciences were just getting a lot of support, towards a challenge-oriented one, where the challenge for the life sciences sector that was more relevant to it was the healthy aging mission. So all of a sudden, the support that the life sciences sector was getting also had to be an input towards a government-led mission that required many different sectors, not just life sciences, but the question was, as part of the industrial strategy, it was no longer just getting benefits, but getting benefits depending on how it was strategizing to be, you know, critical towards a healthy aging strategy. And just one thing on implementation and execution, we talked a lot about it today at the lunch that the governor generously hosted, that idea that actually just coming up with visions is not that hard, but actually then being able to execute, being able to implement, being able to redesign all the different policies I touched on because I went on too long, the procurement, the grants, the loans, the tools, the partnerships, that's critical. But even stuff like how do you evaluate a mission has to change. That's part of the implementation strategy. If we're just using cost-benefit analysis, net present value, These are pretty static metrics that are fine for some things, but if we want to capture, for example, the dynamic spillovers that happen across the economy on the way to the moon, the camera phones, the foil blankets, the baby formula, and measure that mission on whether it catalyzes that Keynesian multiplier, that means all of a sudden your, we call it the green book in the UK, needs to include metrics that are much more dynamic that can actually capture that economy-wide transformation. So that's part of the implementation strategy, not just the ex-ante, but the ex-post evaluation process.
Thank you. We're going to take just two more questions, Dr. Williams, and then the gentleman, behind there.
Thank you very much. First of all, let me compliment you on your presentation. It was most absorbing, and I know it's given us a lot of food for thought. I just wanted to mention something which perhaps you might have noticed before, that there is something which you might call the creeping of conditionality back into financing. I think that we had an engagement with the lenders in order to get them to come off this conditionality thing. And it seems to be coming back. So I just wanted to put a word out there to ask that we be very careful about that. We work hard to stop it from reducing the lending that you're getting. And we might be, undoing it.
Dr. Williams is more talking about the conditionalities that would have happened at the macroeconomic level with respect to the neoliberal and the Washington consensus. The truth is, however, that we need conditionalities for domestic development and domestic growth. And I think that's the difference with what we're seeing here. The problem is that conditionalities are conditionalities and defined the same way in the dictionary. And we have to be able then to determine what is good and what is bad in the same way that when people tell me that we're experiencing growth, I don't want growth alone, I want inclusive growth. Mm-hmm. I want growth that everybody can benefit in, because you can have growth mm-hmm. without jobs, you can have growth mm-hmm. without equity. Mm-hmm. And in fact, that's really the major problem in the Western world, mm-hmm. that the level of inequity has grown in the last few decades, largely because of the concentration of the modalities that matter. And we've seen it play out only too sadly in the United States of America, that now finds itself at its closest point to civil disruption since the Civil War of the 19th century.
Thank you.
Yeah, can I just address that as well? Because you're absolutely right. Sometimes that word conditionality comes back to bite because of what it also reminds us of. So what I was talking about was exactly the opposite of the types of conditionalities that came from the macro side. Again, mm-hmm. IMF loans, conditional on, as I was talking about at the beginning, what we could just call, for this, to be quick here, austerity. What's interesting in Europe is today, so we had, as I mentioned, conditionality linked to deficit reduction after the financial crisis. It failed miserably. It increased the debt to GDP ratios in most countries. But today, the conditions of the next gen EU recovery program is $2 trillion. It's conditional on member states having a plan around climate and digitalization. It's very easy to come up with plans. So they've all come up with plans. They've gotten money. Italy's gotten a big chunk, $300 billion from the next gen EU. The money comes, no idea how to implement. So that attention that we were talking about today to process, the question that just came about on execution, implementation. If we don't invest within the dynamic capabilities within our public institutions, even when they do get the fiscal space, and they have to fight for that fiscal space due to those neoliberal ideas that actually reduced it. The problem is when they do get the fiscal space, if they haven't been investing within the dynamic capabilities of administrative capacity, they sometimes can't even spend the money. Italy has historically had to send money back to Europe that they got through the structural funds because the money landed and they couldn't actually invest it capably. And I think we don't talk enough about that from the progressive side, right? It gets used just to bash government. Oh, they don't know what they're doing. Then invest within that administrative capacity. That is an investment. And that's why I wrote the big con, the consultification of our administrative capacity. But the other thing is I prefer the word reciprocity in increasingly. I was speaking recently with Minister Patel in South Africa, where he was explaining also some of the very interesting conditions that they were setting up with Pepsi-Cola and with some of the beer, the breweries, on making sure that they were investing in the workforce, in better working conditions, in local capacity. And we talked about the need for a better word than conditionality because it caused a bit of trauma thinking about that word in terms of how the macroeconomic finance has been dysfunctionally creating problematic conditions. So the word reciprocity also is part of what I talk about in terms of symbiotic, mutualistic ecosystems between public and private versus parasitic, predator-prey ecosystems. And any biologist, unlike lazy economics, will force you to define what do you mean? What does a mutualistic reciprocity ecosystem look like versus a parasitic one? And there's an opportunity, I think, to use the S and the G of ESG, if we can revive it after it being kind of, you know, because there was a lot of greenwashing in ESG, but it's still important for companies also to be held accountable. But the S and the G were much lazier than the E, and I think critical to that, the G and the S, is how is that company working with other organizations around it? And it comes back to the vaccine. Look at the Pfizer vaccine, the AstraZeneca vaccine, completely different in how they work with public institutions. And we need more examples like that. How do we scale up proper symbiotic partnerships and scale down the problematic ones? And how do we use conditionality or reciprocity in order to steer an economy towards more inclusive and sustainable growth in the design of the partnerships?
Thank you. The gentleman, and that is our final question.
Good evening, Madam Prime Minister, and buon pomeriggio to you, la señora. I just want to ask you one question in everything that you've said, very well presented and well thought out. Do you think that in order to diversify our local economy, do you think, in your professional opinion, and either you or Madam Prime Minister can answer, can we look up to the Singapore model in order to help us diversify our local economy? Do you think that that could be a good way to go? Grazie.
I mean, you know, people use the Singaporean model all the time as an example, including with Brexit. They said, oh, we're going to go down the Singaporean model, forgetting that 80% of the land in Singapore is in public hands. So Singapore is extremely different from many countries. One of the interesting things that I've learned, actually, Tarman Shanmugaratnam, who's one of my co-chairs on the Water Commission, is now president of Singapore. Yeah. And one of the interesting things about Singapore has been the attention that they've paid to the talent recruited within government. And it's not just, I mean, I think there's two sides of it. One is the pay. They actually pay their civil servants very well, and the political class. But most countries can't do that. Most countries.
I don't
can't
think
do
people
that.
Know that the Prime Minister of Singapore, I think, earns about 1.5 million US a year.
All the ministers do.
And the ministers earn close to that, but they have zero tolerance for corruption and zero tolerance for incompetence, so that people don't last very long.
But I think there's two sides of Singapore. One is very different structure of ownership. Second is what allowed Singapore to develop was a very visible hand. There's Ha Jun Chang has written about this, kicking away the ladder, when he looks at different Asian countries in terms of how they actually protected their industry instead of just opening it up right away in order for it to develop, and looking at both tariff policy and others. But also, you know, one of the best ways to get talent into government is not just by paying the ministers a million, it's actually by having a goal. And I was very interested, the only moment that the US government actually really brought in a lot of talent recently was when Obama, post-financial crisis, said, we're gonna have a stimulus program, when Europe was just doing austerity and so on. We're going to direct that stimulus program in a green direction. So they had an $800 billion stimulus program initially before the Tea Party got in the way to green the whole economy. And he ended up getting Steve Chu, a Nobel Prize winning Chinese-American physicist. Mm-hmm. He won the Nobel Prize in physics to say, I'll help. He became minister of the Department of Energy, head of the Department of Energy. Would he have agreed to do that, had the task been come in and help us fix market failures and de-risk the Elon Musks of the future? Of course not. So the Singaporean model, in terms of also attracting the talent, people often talk about the pay, and it's true, the ministers get a lot of money, but it also has been an honor and an interest, the kind of mission mystique purpose. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you go into a government because the government is seen as that it also has a purpose. So both the policies that allowed Singapore, but many East Asian countries to develop, the talent recruitment, but also the issues around ownership, which people often don't talk about, I think are part of that kind of Singaporean miracle.
Thank you. Go ahead,
Fermi. I can, because the public space matters a lot there. And I think that we haven't necessarily valued the extent to which we have the platform for it. But we need to push past now what is an inconvenient truth, that we get frightened when major transformation starts to come about. Barbados cannot manage in the 21st century with a 19th century criminal justice system, with an early 20th century educational system, as former principal of Courage and Power, Mr. Adams, mm-hmm. pointed out just now, with a welfare system that is 19th century, with a traffic system that is based in the middle 20th century. If we want to be able to move forward, as I said, we can't be playing catch up. We have to do leapfrog. And it is only in leapfrogging that we then begin to command the attention of the world, and we command the attention of those whose resources we need, whether in terms of skills or whether in terms of other forms of capital. But as we end, I want you to get copies of this book or get it digitally. And I thank Mariano and the Institute and Sarah for its production, working along with the officials in the government and the social partnership. But this page to me is compelling, and it is short enough for us and certainly for me to end on it, because crossed out is picking winners. Mm-hmm. Instead is picking the willing. Crossed out is outsourcing. Instead is capacity building, and that's what we need to be doing in the public service again, having presided over an exodus of so many people from it. Crossed out is cost benefit, and instead is dynamic spillovers. Crossed out is flying markets, and instead is co-creating and shaping. Crossed out is de-risking, and instead is welcoming uncertainty. You gotta almost become a surfer. Crossed out is leveling the playing field, and instead is tilting towards a direction. If there is nothing else we leave here with, there has to be an understanding that this country will only succeed if we understand our purpose and our mission. And I keep repeating those two words, because even with all of us going in the right direction, it will not be sufficient, because we just do not have enough hands lifted. Mm-hmm. And that is exactly why I want to rebuild the capacity in the public service, and that is exactly why people must see service in the public domain as an honor. As an honor, and not AI that is clearly being used there. The bottom line is that we have to give back. And whether the operation give back is at the level of the students at the university who are now being asked to give back in exchange for the government paying their tuition fees, or whether it is at the level of persons at the beginning, middle, or end of their career, we need people to give and see 3, 5 years, 7 years minimum in the public space, either as employees or in executive or in chair positions or in board membership positions, if the country is going to be able to be propelled forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Excellent wrap, Prime Minister.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Certainly.
So thank you, and I shouldn't speak after the Prime Minister because she's so inspirational and be great to end on that, but I just want to say out of respect also for Minister Corey Lane, who's really, I've learned so much from, I think we also have to give back to the community. We talked a lot of, in the way you said, but even further, we talked about the public, private, reciprocity, conditionality. There's something about, for example, what you've been doing, which I'm just learning, so I'm just kind of repeating what I'm hearing. I have nothing to say. But for example, when you brokered in a very intelligent way, putting yourself on the line, a deal between gangs, right? And I mean, I live in London. We have huge gang problems. What is then the deal? Not just public, private, not just conditionality, reciprocity from the macro to the, you know, design of the business state relationship, but with the community. What do we owe back, right? Mm-hmm. In terms of, you were talking about whether it's taxi licenses, whether investment in the creative arts into the communities that make sure that these deals, I mean, literally, this is a deal between criminal organizations, unless we think anyone is born a criminal, which, you know, no one is born a criminal. The social and economic determinants of crime, if we take that perspective in an outcomes-oriented way to reduce crime and gang crime in particular to zero, ideally, right? I mean, we're thinking about that in London with knife crime amongst teenagers, zero knife crime. What does it mean for the investments we have to be making into those communities as part of that deal? And I just think, you know, I'm just saying it, I just wanted to say it because in looking at that red shirt that he's wearing, it just reminded me, we need to be talking about investment in the community, by the community, and that idea of ownership means also agency, and that's why I've also been inspired in Camden, going from food banks to food cooperatives, giving agency and decision-making to the communities as opposed to just thinking that they're benefiting from some super smart prime minister, super smart academic coming on stage, talking about great policies and everyone's gonna benefit. Who's making those decisions? Who's at the table? The labor unions, but also the community is central. And without that, we get the kind of civil war we're getting in the US.
Thank you very much. We've had a very vibrant conversation. Thank you very much, Prime Minister. Thank you very much, Professor. I would like now to invite Governor Greenidge to show our collective appreciation for the conversation and the involvement of our panelists. So we're going to present you each with a gift. So if you can just step forward, Prime Minister, and then Professor. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Just step forward. Mm-hmm. Go ahead. Sorry. She brought yours on first. Thank you. We're going to take it. And next to the professor. And this is a Never Look All piece, a painting of Tent Bay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, and another round of applause. And as Professor Mazzucato prepares to exit the stage, I would like to invite our Deputy Governor, Mr. Alwyn Jordan, to deliver the vote of thanks. Mr. Jordan?
The Honorable Mia Amar Motley, Prime Minister of Barbados, the Honorable Corey Lane, Minister of State in the Office of the Attorney General, other members of Cabinet, members of the Senate, members of Parliament, Dr. Kevin Greenidge, Governor of the Central Bank of Barbados, Deputy Governors Ms. Michelle Doyle and Mr. Elson Gaskin, members of the Bank's Board of Directors,
former governors of the Central Bank, Dr. Marianne Williams and Mr. Cleverson Haynes, our distinguished lecturer, Professor Mariana Mazzucato, management and staff of the Central Bank of Barbados, members of the Scott family, members of the media, visiting dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I am honored to deliver the vote of thanks on behalf of the board, management, and staff of the Central Bank of Barbados at this esteemed lecture in honor of the late Sir Arlyle Winston Scott. In this vein, I ask you please to join me in recognizing Ms. Pamela Hope and Dr. Kamal Hope, his daughter and granddaughter, who are here with us tonight. Thank you for your unwavering support for this lecture series and for allowing us to honor your patriarch each year. Ladies and gentlemen, as has been said by previous speakers, we can all agree that it has been refreshing to gather again in person after 3 years of virtual events. We've enjoyed an enlightening and thought-provoking lecture on the topic, Directing Inclusive and Sustainable Economic Growth, a Mission-Oriented Strategy. This topic is significant for us at the bank, given our role as policy advisor to the government, especially in light of the many uncertainties and global polycrises that continue to affect our nation. Allow me, therefore, to express sincere gratitude to our distinguished guest speaker, Professor Mariana Mazzucato. Thank you for your compelling insights into how a mission-oriented approach can result in economic growth that is innovation-led, sustainable, and inclusive. Your strategy for starting with a significant challenge and then determining how we can transform all aspects of our economy to address that challenge is crucial at this juncture in our development. You've inspired us to take bold action as we forge ahead, like those who worked on the Apollo program. We also owe a debt of gratitude to the Prime Minister. Thank you for accepting the invitation to join our panel, and more generally, for your role as a global leader in the fight for equity when it comes to harnessing and galvanizing resources to assist vulnerable countries in dealing with climate change. The discussion here tonight was enlightening, and you've given us much to ponder. You have helped us to relate the professor's views to our environment, and we greatly appreciate your presence here tonight. To Governor Greenidge, thank you for continuing the legacy of your predecessors in supporting this lecture series by delivering the introductory remarks and for presenting our token of appreciation to Professor Mazzucato. You are continuing a rich tradition here at the bank and also forging a new chapter as we seek to internalize excellence as an institution. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in recognizing and congratulating the St. Leonard's Boys School Choir again for the beautiful rendition of the national anthem. And also for our soothing rendition of Emerton by saxophonist Daniel Harvey. Their involvement in this series reflects the bank's ongoing support for young people, culture, and the arts. I also want to take this opportunity to recognize the many individuals who worked tirelessly, mainly behind the scenes, to help make this lecture a success, including the corporate communications team of Ms. Noveline Brewster, who also serves as our moderator tonight and kept everyone to the tight schedule, our lead organizer, Ms. Shianika Mears, Ms. Sherry Bishop, Ms. Natasha Beckles, Mr. Matthew Williams Rawlings, and Ms. Shirlene Padmore. I also express gratitude to the management and staff of the Frank Collymer Hall, maintenance, the services section, security, and our team of ushers, ably led by Ms. Katrina Ford. And finally, to each of you who joined us tonight, thank you for your rapt attention and thought-provoking questions. You have contributed significantly to this event's success, and I think that deserves a round of applause. Ladies and gentlemen, I hope you enjoyed your time with us and feel inspired and energized. I invite you now to join us in the terrace for some light refreshments and to continue the stimulating conversation which we began this evening. Enjoy the rest of your night and safe travels. I thank you.
Thank you very much, DG. And before you depart the hall, we have one little piece of music by our saxophonist, Colors. It's it's Independence. And so let's celebrate with Mr. Harvey. And after that, we will go to the refreshment. So, Mr. Harvey.
Thank you.
So thank you, Governor. We needed that to take us out onto the terrace and to our cocktail reception, where we will continue to ponder on tonight's lecture. There are three messages that resonated with me, and as we depart, I will share them with you. Let us be market shapers, not fixers. This approach, mission-oriented approach to economic development requires all hands on deck. You, me, your brother, your sister, your mother, your aunt, everybody. And you know what? We have to be going sharing the burden, but Prime Minister, I heard you. We're going to also benefit from what? The bounty. And that I look forward to. So on that note, thank you so much for coming out tonight. I invite you to spare a few minutes with us as we continue the discussion. Please stand for the departure of the official party first. Thank you so much. Happy independence. God bless you. And travel home safely once you leave here. Thank you very much, everyone.